Hi, and welcome to Google Developers Live. With me today is my colleague Mauru.
Hi, Peng.
Hey, Mauru. And what we're talking about today is the Google Wallet Objects API. This is another video in our series of videos about the Wallet Objects API. And today, we're going to talk about the Wallet Objects Quickstart for Ruby. The goal of these Quickstarts is to help you hit the ground running in your Wallet Objects API integration. In each of these Quickstarts, we cover a few things. We cover, hey, how do you authorize OAuth 2 access to the resources? We cover how to insert a wallet objects class. We cover save to wallet and how to create a wallet object. And lastly, we cover the wallet web service API, which is how do you enable a discoverable and how do you allow people to sign up for specifically loyalty objects. And to walk through getting the Ruby Quickstart up and running, here's Mauru.
Thank you, Peng. Now, let's go into our documentation to get the instructions on how to download, install, and configure the Ruby Quick Start. First thing is go to our developers.google.com/commerce/wallet. And then from there, go to the Google Wallet Objects and click on Quick Start Samples and then Ruby. Once you're there, the first thing that I recommend you do is watch the video that we have on how to set up your account, your OAuth account, and get your credentials. Once you do that, then the first thing we're gonna do is download the sample code. To do that, we're gonna go into GitHub. Our code is open source, and you can download it or you can clone it from GitHub. To do that, the URL is github.com/googlewallet/walletobjects-quickstart-ruby. From here, we can just copy the URL and clone it or download it to our local computer. On my computer here, I have it already cloned. So this is our directory. And these are the files that we have for the Quick Start. And take now a copy of your private key, the one that you downloaded when you created your credentials, and copy it into this directory. In my case, my private key is called wobs-privatekey.p12. So this, I already created it and copied it into this directory. Now, let's go and configure and make sure that we're using the credentials that we got into our project. To do that, let's open the file called wobs-constants.rb. So I'm going to open it here in my editor, and I already have it here. And from here, let's change some of these values. The first one is the service account email address. To get that, you'll need to go into the cloud, onto your cloud console here, and then click on APIs, register apps, I'm sorry, service account project. And from here, this is your email address that you'll need to use for your as a service account email address. So I'm just going to copy that and paste it here in my file. Good. And also now let's get your issuer ID. You can find that from the merchant dashboard. So in here, just by going into account management, we can copy paste the issuer ID. So we're copying that into here. And now go into the service account private key. For the service account private key, this is the name of my private key, but if you have a different name, you also need to modify that. The application name, this value doesn't need to match any of the values that you have when you created your account. So in our case, we have by default Wallet Objects API demo, and you can leave that value there. For the origins, this URL is the URL where we're going to be running the Quick Start locally. So we have localhost and then port 8080. If you're going to be changing the port, then you need to modify this value. Otherwise, you can leave it as is. Then we have four different IDs for the loyalty class object ID, for the class object, and for the offers as well. In this case, you can leave them as is, or we can modify them. If you've been running the Quick Start and you want to create a new class, then you'll need to change these. So let's say demo one for each of these. Once we have these, we should be able to run the Quick Starts. But before we do that, let's make sure that we have our prerequisites done here. So first, let's check our Ruby version. So to do that, just run version. And I'm running 2.0, you need to be running at least 193. So if that's good and you don't need to upgrade your Ruby, then now let's move into our gems. For the gems, we need to have 4 gems installed for this, for the quick start. We need to have JSON, the Google API client, the Jot, and Sinatra. So let's run, maybe you already have some of these installed. So first let's run gem query local to see which ones we have. And in my case, I have them all. I have Sinatra, Google API client, JSON, and Jot. If you don't have one of these, then it's very easy. Just do gem install and the name of the gem. So I can do here JSON. So since I already installed them, we don't need to do that. Now, once we have that, we have the correct version of Ruby. We downloaded the code. We also have all our gems installed, and we modified all our parameters. Now, all we need to do is just run it. To do that, very easy. We're using Sinatra to run the server, and we'll call it by doing Ruby whoops server, which is the name of the Ruby script that we're running, and then minus P to say that we want to run it on a specific port. In this case, I'm running it on port 8080. So once we run it now, it's telling us that it's running on port 8080. Everything's good. Sinatra is running. So now let's go into our browser and see how this looks. So I have here, we're going to go into localhost port 8080. Once we run this, you'll see that we have that it's successfully running. Now, what do we have in this page? We have 2 steps. The first step, it says insert a class, so either a loyalty class or an offer class. And then we have 2 save to wallet buttons. How does this work? The first thing that you do is that you'll need to have a class for either or for whatever vertical you're working with. So let's say that we're doing the loyalty. You'll need to insert the class first, and this is only done once in the system. You can also, of course, update classes after you've inserted them, but you only need to insert it once. So this button will not be on your site. This is only here for us to test and show you how to create classes every time you modify something on the code. But then after we've inserted the class, then you will have a button, or you most probably will have a button to save the card or a coupon to the user's wallet. So this button, once we click it, it will create an object on my Google Wallet account where I'm signed in here. And then we'll be able to see that on the phone, on the Google Wallet app. So first, let me create the class by just clicking on that. Then it says that it's inserted the class loyalty class demo 1, which is how we named it. And now I go into save card to wallet, and it saved the card already. So now when we go into our Google Wallet app, we'll see it saved, and we'll do that during our demo.
And to get a better idea of what classes and objects are, we also have another Google Developers Live video covering the concept of wallet objects that you can take a look at.
Now let's go and look at the Web Service API integration. We also provide a sample code for this in our Quick Start. And how this works is if from the Google Wallet app, whenever a user clicks on either a member or join the program, what Google does is Google will send the information in a JSON request to your web service. Then you will process on your end to either create a new object or send us an existing object. If this is a user that already has, a loyalty card with you, send that information back to us in JSON, and then we will display it on the phone. So let's look at how we can configure that in our discoverable. From here, from the browser on the merchant dashboard, if I go into discoverables, you'll see here that I'm going to edit it. And there's a section called merchant callback configuration. So in here, you need to add the URL to the host where you're running your Quickstart sample. And here, we need it to be running somewhere outside, not on your local site, so it can be reachable from our web service and from our service. And then the port, and we recommend that this is running over SSL. For testing, you can run it over regular HTTP, but for when you launch the application, it needs to be running over SSL. then the path to the web service on our sample, it's web service. And of course, you can change that later to whatever makes sense for you, your application. Once we have this, we'll, whenever there's a request, then Google will send the JSON request to you and you'll respond back to it. Peng is going to do a demo on how this works on the phone, and then we'll go over the code and see where all of this is happening in the sample.
All right, let's take a look at the phone. This is the latest wallet app. And within this wallet app, if you see a few things, this is what we call the Here Now page. As you'll see, I have one loyalty program that I've joined. And this occurred when Mauru clicked Save This to Wallet during the demo. So let's take a look at that wallet program first, or let's take a look at that loyalty object first. It's Bacon Rista Rewards. This is our demo merchant. And within it, you can see that, hey, I have 500 points, that the tier I am is gold, that it's Mauru who joins, and some additional details that a merchant could provide for their loyalty objects. Now let's take a look at what a discoverable is and the web service API. So in order to join a new program, let's say I'm in the store or something, I wanted to join your loyalty program, I could hit plus to find the loyalty programs that are available to me. This list will also be sorted, and it'll show programs that in the future will be relevant to your location. In this case, I'm going to join our test merchant, which is ZC Bacon Rista Rewards. So let's take a look at this discoverable and some details about it. Bacon plus coffee, your best morning every day. And yes, I'd love to join this one, so I'll click join. So all of this information that you see now is information that's populated from my Google Wallet / Google account. And this information can be modified by changing some conditions in the discoverable that Mauru just showed. I accept the terms of service, and yeah, I'll take some promotional emails from this merchant, and I'll create the account. So this will take a few seconds to call back to the web service that Mauru just showed, and then it'll return an object to the Google service, which will then push the object display back down to my device. In this case, I have a second card with a balance. So in this case, maybe I could show this balance and use it as my stored value or something in the future. So that's a quick demo. Now here's Mauru to talk about how everything works.
From the discoverable, there's one thing that we need to make sure we have set up once we're doing testing on our end, is that the status of the discoverable needs to be draft. If it's draft, that means that no one can see it publicly, but we can see it on testing mode. Also, you will need to share, if you go to account management, you'll need to share with the account that you're using. In my case here, GWallet demo is the email address that Peng is using on the phone. So as long as you get your discoverable, you set it on draft, and you share with the email addresses of the accounts that you want to share your discoverable with, then you can use it on test mode. So it won't be live to anyone except you when you're testing. Now let's look at some of the code and see how this all works out. I'm going to open here the editor. And for the Ruby sample, we have most of the code is included in the web server RB file. And what we're doing here is we have, first in this area, we have the authentication, and we're doing that using auth2. You have your credentials, you have your private key, and your service account email address. After doing that, let me open first the index.html so we can look at it. When we open the sample, the first thing you see is the index.html page, right? In there, we have the two steps. The first one has the buttons to insert the loyalty class, and the second one has the save to wallet buttons. So on the first one, where we have the insert loyalty class, we can see that these buttons are rendered and they're here. Let me open it here. On the JS file that we are including within the index.html file, we are associating an action to these. When we click on the loyalty, then we're going to be calling insert/loyalty. The same for the offer button here, we're going to be calling insert/offer. Then we also have, when you're calling the loyalty save or offer save, when the page loads, we're calling JWT/loyalty, and then we're also calling the job/offer for the other button. And what this is doing is that it's rendering the gsafe to wallet tag on the button, which will, based on the JS file that we're including on the index.html, will render the nice safe to wallet button that you see on the page. So how does this work? When you call the, first let's look at the JOT for the safe to wallet button. How this works is that you'll go into the web server and we'll find here the path. We're saying if you're calling JOT/anything, then call this. And what this is doing is that it's creating a JOT and it's including the information of the object that we're creating, either a loyalty object or an offer object. So this is what we're doing. We're saying if it's, the type is loyalty, then we generate an object and then we add the object to the payload and then we encode the JOT and we just, here, we're just outputting that. So what it's doing is that if you see the page, when we load it and you just inspect the element, you'll see that it has the JOT on the URL for that button. Then also we have the insert. If you're gonna insert a class, then we also have, if you post to insert with a type, what we're doing in here is that we're generating a class also based on the ID that we created on the WOPS constants. And then we're calling the API here. We're calling our REST API to insert the object, the class in this case. And that is returning back an answer and that is displayed on the page on the index.html. Then the last path that we need to look at here is the web service. And this is the one that was configured from the discoverable. And when you call web service, what it's doing is that it's checking, it's getting, in our case, we are assuming that we have success, a successful response all the time, but you can change this value to return a different message. So we're saying if it's successful here, we're gonna create a JOT and we're going to send back on the payload that the result is approved and we're gonna send the loyalty object back to Google. So how this works here is that we're generating an object here and we always generate the same one for the sample, but on your case, you would say, oh, it's a new member. So we generate a new object and you generate this object on your end and then you send back the information to us. And then, of course, you put it on the payload and you encode it and send it back the same way that we do with the other path, with the JOT path. If the response is not successful, then you don't have to send an object. The only thing you send back is an error message and the result is rejected. In that case, then Google will display an error on the Google Wallet app. We also provide on this sample other paths to be able to list classes and list objects and get specific objects. And those are just examples on how to call the RESTful APIs using Ruby. This concludes the Google Wallet Objects Ruby Quickstart video. We hope you found this video helpful. For more videos, please visit us at developers.google.com/livewallet. You can also find us in Google Plus and or Twitter.
Yeah, and thanks for joining us for another week of Google Developers Live. See you
next time.